All right, we are going to pray together and start this part of our program. God, you are good beyond our wildest dreams. You are a father like none other. You are the lover of our wounded souls. You created us, you made us, you shaped us. And you know the story of every woman as she sits here tonight or she listens online. She's an overflow or in this room or someplace else in the country or around the world. You know us as we sit here. We're known by you. And because of that, we can be absolutely confident that we're also loved by you. So I pray that at the end of this night, that women will walk out of here knowing, if they don't know anything else and they don't feel anything else, they will leave absolutely convinced, maybe for the first time, that the God of the universe knows their name, knows each woman by name, loved her, created her, and cannot wait to be in relationship with her. Would you bless this time as we look at your word? In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Okay. Well, in this message part of the evening, we are going to contemplate the theme, which is the calling. Now, I don't know about you, but to me, that always sounds a bit mysterious. Yeah, you've got some paper there that you can take some notes. It's got all the verses that we're going to be covering. I figured I was going to go over them kind of fast, and you might have a hard time writing them down, so I've written them down for you. But this concept of the calling is a little bit mysterious, a little bit cryptic, and I definitely think it requires some explanation. One of the problems with the English language is that we use some of the same word to mean completely different things. It makes learning English difficult for people. And for instance, the word call, I mean, we use the word call, we call our dog. It's like, get over here, dog, I need you right now. Get here on this spot. It's kind of an order. We call pigs in the United States, you know, we use that same word. We call our friends on the phone a little bit differently. We shift that meaning of the word call from get over here right now to hey, I want to connect with you, I'm calling you. We use it when we name our children. We say they are called or they are named. It has to do with making something personal. And so calling can also mean, we tend to think of it as a career goal or something that you're doing with your life, but it's really easy to see why the calling could be confusing and a little ambiguous and leave you not really knowing what we're going to be talking about tonight. So I want to stop and look at what God says about call and calling. And there's several ways that God uses this that I think have important implications for us. The first is that God calls us to salvation. The very first call that God gives to us is to salvation. In Mark 2:17, Jesus said, when he was identifying why he had come to earth, he said, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners." Then in 1 Peter 2:9, Peter says, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light." Peter says there that all of us were in darkness, spiritual darkness, before we came to know Jesus Christ, before we established a personal relationship with him. And he says, it is not just bad, he says it's dark. You're living in spiritual darkness, and God has called you out of that darkness into his wonderful life. So his first call to us is to salvation. A second call, as it kind of progresses, is God calls us to fellowship or to closeness and intimacy with Jesus. In 1 Corinthians 1:9, it says, "God, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, is faithful." Fellowship is one of those words that's really rich in meaning, and it has to do with being completely connected, that you're walking side by side, hand in hand with someone, that you're seeing eye to eye. And so when we are now in fellowship with God because of Jesus Christ, we have an intimacy. We have an ability to take our relationship from not even just Jesus is my Savior, but Jesus is my friend. In fact, he's my closest friend. God calls us not to salvation and not just to salvation, not just to fellowship, but he also calls us into holy living. That's where we start getting a little uncomfortable, because we like the parts where Jesus wants to be our Savior and Jesus wants to be our friend. We like that. We don't like it when we get into the part where Jesus says, "And I'd also like you to learn how to live a holy life," because that sort of infringes on the way we like to do things, but it is part of our calling. 2 Timothy 1:9, it says that he has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. So part of being in this fellowship, this intimacy, this salvation relationship with Jesus is that over time we're to grow into holiness, and he teaches us how to do that. And then God calls us into service. Galatians 5:13, Paul says there, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love." So this God who saves us, who wants us to be in fellowship with him, who says that we are to serve him in our freedom that he's given to us and these holy lives. And then he says God calls us to live by faith. 2 Thessalonians 1:11 says, "With this in mind, we constantly pray for you, that our God may count you worthy of his calling, and that by his power he may fulfill every good purpose of yours and every act prompted by your faith." So from this calling that God gives to us, it's supposed to generate faith within us so that we are willing to not just be, but to actually do, to actually be active in our world. Well, that leads me this week, as I've been studying for this, to two amazing women who lived a life of daring faith. We've just finished about an 8 to 10 week series at Saddleback talking about daring faith and how our faith has been challenged to go beyond where we've been into new territory, to try new things, to explore, to step out in faith, to take risks. And I want to talk to you about two women in the Bible who did that, who let that calling from God to salvation, to holiness, to intimacy, to service, and then into daring faith. It's in Judges 4 and 5, and I'm going to read these to you. They're up on the screen, a little bit of a long passage, but I want you to catch the story. And the first woman is Deborah. So in Judges 4:1-6, and I'm going to read it here off the screen in front of me. "Again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, now that Ehud was dead. So the Lord sold them into the hands of Jabin, king of Canaan, who reigned in Hazar." By the way, I have to just tell you, none of us know how to pronounce these names. So if you just say them confidently, people will believe you. So I'm gonna plunge into some of these names and places, and you're gonna believe that I know what I'm talking about, okay? So Sisera, the commander of his army, was based in Harosheth Hagoyim. See, you like that. "Because he had 900 chariots fitted with iron and had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years, they cried to the Lord for help. Now Deborah, a prophet, the wife of Lapidoth, was leading Israel at that time. She held court under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites went up to her to have their dispute settled. She sent for Barak, son of Abinoam, from Kedesh in Naphtali, and said to him, 'The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun and lead them up to Mount Tabor. I will lead Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops to the Kishon River and give him into your hands.' Barak said to her, 'If you go with me, I will go. But if you don't go with me, I won't go.' 'Certainly I will go with you,' said Deborah. 'But because of the course you're taking, the honor will not be yours, for the Lord will deliver Sisera into the hands of a woman.' So Deborah went with Barak to Kedesh, and there Barak summoned Zebulun and Naphtali, and 10,000 men went up under his command, and Deborah also went up with him." Okay, so Deborah. Her name means honeybee. I don't know, maybe she's Southern. It just sounds like, you know, anybody's going to be called honeybee. It's got to be from the South. But she was, the Bible says, a judge or a prophetess in Israel at that time. And that was very unusual for a woman to be leading the nation of Israel. And the Bible says there in Judges 4 that she sat under a palm tree, and it came to be known, the palm of Deborah. And when she sat there, the people would come, and they would bring to her their concerns. You can see some pictures here. I've got a couple of them. There is a beautiful picture of Deborah and the palm tree that she sat next to. And the people would come, and they would bring to her their issues and the things that they needed assistance with, and she helped them. So a judge, I mean, when we think of judge in the English language, we can't help but think of somebody in the black robes, sitting behind a big wooden desk, who's handing down judgments or legal sentences to people. That's not what it meant when the Bible called her or any of the other judges in the book of Judges a judge. Judges had primarily two roles. They were tribal leaders more than they were judges who handed down legal judgments. And they had two primary roles. They had an external role, which was to help the people find peace and harmony with those who were oppressing them. And they had an internal role, which was to talk to the people and to be, listen to this, an instigator and an agitator toward living holy lives. I love that. They were externally supposed to help the people be at peace in a military sense, and in an internal sense, as they talked to the Israelites, these judges were supposed to be instigators and agitators to move the people toward holy living. Keep that in mind as we go along. Well, this period of history was certainly not the nation of Israel's finest hour. They had this habit, this habitual habit of getting into these cycles of where they would follow God for a period of time. They would love God. They would profess how much they loved him, how much they were going to serve him, how much he meant to them, how he was their God. And they made all these strong declarations of their love and fidelity and loyalty to God. But then they would get caught in some kind of a sin, and because they were living in Canaan, where there were a lot of folks who worshipped pagan gods, a lot of fertility gods, the Israelites would get caught up in those pagan rituals, pagan ceremonies. They would think, well, if the pagans have these great fertility rituals and they have better crops, maybe we need to do some of that ourselves. And so they would get caught up in worshiping false idols, false gods, and God would be angry with them and tell them, I am your true God. I'm the one who is your deliverer. And they would walk away from him. And God would allow another nation or another group of people to suppress them or enslave them or pretty much hassle them until the people again understood that they had walked away from their true God and in repentance would come back to him. And unfortunately, that cycle continued on for many generations. So when we find Deborah, as she's sitting under her palm tree, the nation of Israel is in one of those down cycles. They are in a period where they have been oppressed and hassled by the Canaanites for 20 years. And so Deborah, God calls her into this time of conflict and war. And in Judges 5:7, it says that she was called to lead the attack on the king of the Canaanites, who had made the life of the Israelites miserable for 20 years. And these chapters tell us, especially chapter 5 of Judges, tell us that they had made life so hard for the Israelites. They were raiding their crops. They were marauders. And as people would try to carry on public commerce, they would come and they would steal or they would disrupt it. And so life was disrupted. And the Israelites didn't live in a walled city. You know, many times people in ancient times lived within walled cities because it offered protection from their enemies. And the Israelites were just farmers at that moment. And they had no walled cities to protect them. And so as the Canaanites would disrupt commerce, would disrupt the agriculture and hassle them, they found that their crops weren't able to grow, so they were hungry, they were miserable, and for 20 years they put up with that. But in this moment, in Judges 4 and Judges 4 and 5, we see that God says, okay, they've been crying out to me for deliverance, I will deliver them. So he calls Deborah, this judge sitting under her palm tree, who is obviously a godly woman, and she calls for Barak, who is a military guy. But as you heard in that story, he basically said, I'm not going unless you go, because if you aren't going, I'm not going. And a lot of the scholars who heard that, boy, they have made a heyday with Barak. They've called him a sissy and a wimp and a mama's boy and hiding behind a skirt. And I mean, they have just ridiculed this man for the fact that he said he wasn't going to go into battle unless Deborah went with him. And we don't really know. We don't know if he was a chicken liver. We don't know. We don't know if he was just, maybe she was his good luck charm, kind of like the little rabbit foot in his pocket, you know, kind of thing. We don't really know. That the scripture doesn't tell us. But what we do know is that it displeased God, that Barak's response of saying, yeah, I'm going to go, but I'm not going unless we do it my way, really displeased God. And so Deborah says, fine, I will go with you, but I'm just telling you, you're not getting the credit for this victory. You're going to fight it, and you're going to look like you've won, but I'm just telling you right now that a woman is going to get the credit. So Sisera is the general. He's the bad guy. If Deborah's the, you know, the good guy, then Sisera is really the bad guy. And he's the Canaanite general. And he's got troops of 40,000 strong. You know, the Israelites have 10,000. And he's got 40,000 troops. He's got 900 chariots, the Bible said, iron chariots. And these chariots were not, you know, majestic kind of things. They were war machines. They were killing platforms. They were basically on the flat plains where they lived. They would get in these chariots and chase down the Israelites who were trying to escape, who didn't have horses, who didn't have wonderful military equipment. And these 900 iron chariots were just absolutely flat out killing machines. And they would chase down the people who were running. And so the Israelites were the underdogs in this situation. Only 10,000 of their troops compared to 40,000 of the Canaanite troops. They had no great military weapons. They had no great armor. And here they are gonna go to battle. Well, they do in Judges 5. The Bible tells us that as they go out to battle, that God supernaturally intervenes, and at a time and a season in the calendar year when it should have been dry, God unleashes this ferocious storm. I mean, ferocious storm. And it floods these dry plains, and these big old killing machines, these giant iron chariots get mired in the mud. And so the Canaanites can't chase after the Israelites. The Israelites then come after them because they're basically now sitting ducks, and they kill everybody except for this commander, Sisera, who escapes as a man of great bravery, leading his troops. He escapes on foot, and he runs off. So the story picks up in Judges 4, 17 to 24. Meanwhile, Sisera ran to the tent of Jael, the wife of Heber the Kenite, because Heber's family was on friendly terms with King Jabin, who was the Canaanite king of Hazor. Jael went to meet Sisera, and she said to him, "Come into my tent, sir. Come in. Don't be afraid." So he went into her tent, and she covered him with a blanket. "Please give me some water," he said. I mean, he's exhausted. He's been fighting all day. He says, "I'm thirsty." So she gave him some milk from a leather bag, and she covered him up again. It's like she got him all nice and, you know, cozy, putting his little blankie around him. And he says to her, "So stand at the door of the tent. So if anybody comes, you just tell them that, no, there's nobody here." So when Sisera fell asleep, the Bible says, from exhaustion, Jael quietly crept up to him with a hammer and a tent peg in her hand. And then she drove the tent peg through his temple and into the ground, and he died. You're laughing at that. That's so funny. Well, the Bible goes on to say, when Barak came looking for Sisera, Jael went out to meet him. And she said, "Come, and I'll show you the man that you're looking for." So he followed her into the tent and found Sisera lying there dead with the tent peg through his temple. So on that day, Israel saw God defeat Jabin, the Canaanite king. And from that time on, Israel became stronger and stronger against King Jabin until they finally destroyed him. So we have Deborah, who's this righteous woman, this righteous judge, who's leading Israel at a time that is so unusual for a woman to have that position. But she's obviously a righteous, strong, amazing woman. And then there is Jael, who is a nomadic woman. She lives in a tent. She's wandering. She has no permanent home. And her husband has forged an alliance with the Canaanite king. And this escaping Canaanite general, Sisera, comes because he knows there's this alliance. So he feels it's safe to come to her tent. So he comes to her tent, and she invites him to come in, treats him with extraordinary hospitality. He asks for water. She gives him milk. I mean, which is a step up. You know, you and I drinking hot milk doesn't feel like it's much of a hospitality gesture, but to him, it really was. And so she gives him the warm milk and the cozy blanket, and after he's feeling asleep and he falls asleep, she just literally picks up the tent peg and nails him to the floor. It's pretty gross. Well, and as you see, Barak comes looking for Sisera, and he's expecting, and when she says, "Oh, he's here, come on in," he's expecting, this is my moment of victory, I've routed this whole army, I found the last guy, I'm gonna nail him, he's gonna be done, this battle is gonna be toast, and I will be the hero. And he walks into the tent, and much to his shock and dismay, Sisera is already dead, and you kind of can just have this picture of Jael just sitting there going, You know, I mean, just cool, calm, cucumber. She has taken care of this situation. And the victory went to a woman because of Barak's disobedience. You need to remember that. Well, chapter 4 ends. It says they kept working on him until they finally defeated the king. And then chapter 5 is a poem. If chapter 4 is a kind of by-the-book story, first there was this, then there was this, then there was this, chapter 5 is one of the oldest poems in the Bible, and it's Deborah's victory psalm. It's her song that she sings. And so she takes a lot of license. She uses a lot of beautiful, you can go home tonight and read it. She uses a lot of flowery words. I mean, you can just tell the excitement as she tells the story from a little bit more exciting point of view. She gets very graphic about how Sisera, if you didn't think it was graphic, it gets even more graphic of how she killed Sisera. Deborah, she applauds the tribes that came and helped them out, and she lambasts the tribes that did not come and help in the battle. She tells something which is really amazing to me that I'm going to read to you in Judges 5, 28 to 31. Listen to this. So from the window, now you were jumping ahead. We've heard this beautiful story in a poem that Deborah's told about the battle that day and everything that had happened, and you'd think it would be the end. But the chapter ends this way. From the window, Sisera's mother looked out. Through the window, she watched for his return, saying, "Why is his chariot so long in coming? Why don't we hear the sound of chariot wheels?" Her wise women answer, and she repeats these words to herself, "They must be dividing the captured plunder with a woman or two for every man. There will be colorful robes for Sisera and colorful embroidered robes for me." Yes, the plunder will include colorful robes embroidered on both sides. But Deborah goes on to say, "Lord, may all your enemies die like Sisera, but may those who love you rise like the sun in all of its power." And then there was peace in the land for 60 years. So Sisera's mother, you would think that there would be a little self-pity, maybe, I mean, pity for her. She's waiting for her son. But Deborah knows the kind of woman she is, and we'll come back and talk about that in a minute. So, well, what do we make of the exploits of these two women that are in the Bible who lived thousands of years ago in another part of the world? What in the world does their story and their exploits have for us? What is there for us to glean from the story of Deborah and Jael? Well, I'll get the specifics of why I think this story is so rich in details, but I'll give you the answer to that quickly in this verse, Romans 15, verse 4. Paul says, for everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. So while when you initially listen to that story and you think, okay, well, that had some interesting points to it, that might make a good movie, but I don't really see how it relates to me. Well, this verse tells you right now that this passage, these stories, these two women are in the Bible so that their encouragement and their inspiration will give you hope. So that's where we're going, as we peel out these lessons and tear apart the things that are applicable to us, is at the end of the day, so that it will create hope in us. Because I don't know about you, but there are some days I definitely need inspiration to get out of bed in the morning. Anybody relate? Anybody ever need a little inspiration to get out of bed in the morning? I think we all do. It's what we all experience. And when we read and understand that the Bible is full of people whose lives are meant to be inspirational encouragement to us so that we can have hope, we're going to be more interested in hearing about them and learning what was so special about them that God chose to have them in His Word. So I want to look at the lessons from Deborah and Jael that can lead us to have a renewed faith and hope in our calling. Now, these lessons, I have to tell you, they're going to vary in intensity and common sense. They're going to vary in their amount of common sense. Some of them are so duh that you're going to go, well, that was obvious. And some of them you're going to have to chew on a little bit. But there's both obvious and not so obvious lessons hidden in their story. The first thing that I see here is that God's will, God's calling, always takes place within the limitations and opportunities of this moment. God's calling and His will always take place within the context of the limitations and the opportunities of this moment in time. I mean, I often hear women say this. I've said it myself. Oh, I was just born in the wrong century. How many of you have ever said that? I was just born in the wrong century. You might be attracted to the way that people dressed in a different century or where they lived a simpler life. I mean, who knows what it is that appeals to us about living in another time. But sometimes we get really fanciful and we think, I was just born in the wrong century. I would have done so much better if I'd lived in this time or that time. And the reality is that we need to embrace where God has placed you here and now. Deborah and Jael did not have to face the problems and the difficulties that we faced in 2015. They only had to face the challenges, the opportunities, and the limitations of their moment in time, their little slice of history. That's what they were responsible for. You and I are the ones who are responsible to hear God's calling, to understand what it is that God is asking of us in 2015. God's will and His calling are for us in this moment in time. And you and I have to live out His call for salvation and intimacy and holiness and serving and daring faith now in 2015. The second thing that I see is that Deborah was familiar with God's voice, so that when she heard Him calling her, when she heard Him talking to her, she didn't have to waste a single second going, now, was that God? Oh, gosh, was that God? Oh, He sounds an awful lot like the guy next door. I'm not really sure. Was that, oh, gosh, was that God? I don't know if that was God. She knew Him so well. And how did she know Him well? She had spent time with Him in prayer, in talking to Him, in the scriptures, in being taught. And because she knew God so well, when His voice came to her, she was able to hear it and respond and know what to do. You and I can know God in that same way. We can spend time with God in such a way that when He speaks to us, we don't waste any time or emotional energy trying to figure out if what we've just heard was God speaking to us or something else, or as Rick says, the bad pizza that we ate last night. We don't have to worry about it when we've spent time intimately getting to know God. The third thing that I see about Deborah is that she calls herself in 5 verse 7, she says that she's the mother to Israel. She says, I'm the mother of Israel. And yet the scripture doesn't record that she had any children. We don't see any reason. I mean, there's no reason to believe no children are named. It doesn't say anything about it. But what it does say is that she had that unique, beautiful aspect of nurturing and nourishing that is common to so many women. And so whether she had physical children or not, Deborah saw herself as the mother to this nation, and she nurtured it and nourished it and cared for it so tenderly, even willing to lay down her life if necessary. Again, I see a parallel. Not everyone is going to be a physical mother in this life, but all of us have the ability and the call, if you will, to nurture and nourish those, to mother someone, to expend that kind of tenderness and that kind of nourishing and nurturing response to people who need it, so that we are all mothers, whether you are a physical mother or not. The fourth thing I see is in these two chapters, I see men and women working together to accomplish God's will. When men and women work together to accomplish God's will, it brings glory to God and growth and stability to His kingdom. The kingdom was better because of this partnership between Deborah and Barak and eventually Jael. As the three of them worked together doing what they had been called to do, the kingdom of Israel was strengthened and more stable, and it grew. And that is exactly the same truth that God has today, that when men and women work together, we are able to bring stability and strength to the church, to the kingdom of God, and the kingdom of God is expanded. It's a beautiful lesson to us. The six things that I see, sorry, five, I can't count, is that some of the tribes, I didn't go over this, but if you were to read chapter 5, you would see that some of the troops, because Deborah calls them out, some of the tribes were reluctant to help. They saw this battle, they saw the odds and that they were outnumbered, and some of them for their own reasons. In fact, the tribe of Reuben, it says, they considered it. And they even considered it a second time. But they didn't actually enter the battle. And Deborah just says, you guys were jerks. You were irresponsible. She just lambasts them. And the reality is that sometimes we make excuses for not following God's will or God's calling. And I don't know what your excuse might be tonight. I don't know if it's fear. I don't know if it's if you think that if you do, something terrible will happen, that if you really say yes to God, that the other shoe's going to drop and all hell's going to break loose and your life's going to go to hell in a handbasket if you somehow get close to God. I don't know what your reason might be for being afraid to enter into God's calling, enter into God's will for your life. But I have a feeling that some of you are probably sitting here in this room or in one of the other rooms or online or somewhere in another part of the world, and you are reluctant to say yes, to jump in. You've considered it. You may have even considered it a couple of times, but you've pulled back out of fear, out of selfishness, self-centeredness. I don't really know what your reason is, but bad things happen when we don't give our lives fully to God. We don't get to enjoy the benefits of being in close relationship with Him. Just as these tribes were called out for their lack of joining in, you and I get called out, really, when we say, sorry, God, got other things to do. The sixth thing that I see is that at the end of the day, calling is really about saying yes to God without knowing the question in advance. Calling is about saying yes to God before you even know for sure what it is He's asking you to do. And He may be calling some of you to do battle. As He called Deborah to do a physical battle, He may be calling some of you to battle, to be a warrior for those who are more vulnerable than you, to be a spokesperson, an advocate, someone who speaks up, who uses your voice, your influence, on behalf of those who are more vulnerable than you are. In this particular story, I kind of went over it quickly, but I wanted to come back to that Sisera's mother. This woman was bad news. She was heartless. She was depraved. She was jaded. Because if you could read the Hebrew, if I could read the Hebrew, I can't read the Hebrew, but the scholars tell me that this is what, when she said, listen to her maidservant, listen, Sisera, we can't wait for him to get back because he's delayed because he's plundering and he's trying to find two women for every man. And then he's going to bring me some beautiful clothes that he's going to strip off of the women that he has marauded and probably raped. Actually, when she says two women for every man, the Hebrew says two wombs, two wombs. She's very graphic. She's saying these are women that are going to be used for sexual degradation, and that's okay with me. And so what happened when Jael and Deborah and Barak stopped Sisera? They stopped not only his mother's depravity, but they stopped a man who had habitually and regularly abused women in terrible ways. And God may be calling you to take a stand for those who are more vulnerable than you. Maybe experiences that you've gone through in your life have prepared you to be able to say, I know what that's like, and I'm willing to take a stand against evil in the same way that Jael and Deborah and Barak did. The seventh thing that I see is that Deborah, it's just so interesting to me, Deborah and Jael had no idea that on August 27th, 2015, we would be talking about them. They had no clue. They were just simply living their lives. They were just going about their lives. Deborah as a judge, Jael as a nomadic tent-dwelling woman, an average woman living her life. They had no idea that their actions that day were going to be used by God in such a way that it would change the history of the nation of Israel. And what I love about it is we see their different approach. Deborah planned her attack. She planned it. She called Barak. They had a battle plan. They knew which troops were going to go into battle. She even told them where to go. You go up to Mount Tabor, drive them up that direction. She had a plan for living her life and what she was supposed to do. Jael, on the other hand, had no idea when she got up that morning that the general, Sisera, was going to end up at her tent asking for shelter. She had no clue that that was on the game plan of her day that day. What it says to me is that she recognized an opportunity and she was ready to take it. You and I are going to have moments when God's call in our life requires some deliberate and intentional planning, some thought. There's going to have to be some intentionality about what we do with our lives because it's going to take effort, it's going to take planning, and it's going to take maybe some time to make it all work out. And then there are going to be other times in which God's calling or his will unfolds right before our very eyes, that we didn't know it was going to happen that way that day. And we have to ask ourselves, will I be ready? Will I be ready when God's calling and his will show up right in front of me today in ways that I didn't expect? The eighth thing that I see about Deborah and Jael, truly they inspire me. They're inspiring women. But for me, there are inspiring women all around. There are inspiring women all around us if we will just open our eyes to see them. God's unique call is always to an individual. Yes, God has a call to all of us to salvation. God has a call to all of us, as we read those verses, to come close to him in intimacy, to get to know him. God has this intentional plan for all of us, that we would live holy lives, that we would serve him, that we would live lives of faith. That's universal. God wants that for every single person he's ever made. But God also has some unique parts of your life that are truly unique to you, and his calling is going to be played out differently in your life than it is in mine or the woman next to you. And I love that, because Deborah and Jael illustrate that. Deborah was a public figure. She was a public leader. She had a platform. She was visible. The whole nation of Israel knew who she was. Deborah was a visible and powerful woman. And Jael was a simple, nomadic tent dweller. She was just an average woman. She would have been just like the average person that nobody would probably never even know existed, except for God had a plan for her. But the truth of it is that God's will for us is that some will be visible and some will be more hidden. But both are crucial to fulfilling God's plan for this life, for history. Deborah was needed. Jael was needed. Both of them equally. If Deborah hadn't driven with her plan, the army, to a place where Sisera was almost defeated and was on the run, Jael wouldn't have had the opportunity to finish the job, to issue the coup de grace. And Jael would, if she had not been ready when that moment came to her to do what was called in that moment, it wouldn't have mattered if Deborah had routed the whole army, because this bad guy was still around. Both were needed. Those who are public, those who are more hidden, but both are needed. And I love that God included a public leader and an average woman. That way nobody's got an excuse and nobody's got any reason for pride. We need each other. And there are inspiring women all around us if we'll just look. I don't know if you're willing to be honest, but I think that if we're honest, we sometimes struggle with this. Because instead of looking around for women whose lives will inspire us, instead of looking for women whose lives can inspire us and encourage us to greater faith, to more daring faith, to more hope, to more commitment to Jesus Christ, rather than looking for women whose lives will inspire us, we look around with eyes of jealousy, with eyes of judgment, with eyes of condemnation, sometimes with self-pity. We'll say, well, I can't be like her, so if I can't be like her, then God, I'm not going to serve you at all. I'm not going to do anything if I can't be like her. Or on the reverse, sometimes people will say, God, why won't you let me do this or do that? Here's the answer, guys. Don't ever compare what God has called you to do with what he has called someone else to do. God has a unique and an individual calling on your life. And when we start comparing and judging instead of looking at each other for inspiration and encouragement, we get into trouble. John 21 is one of my favorite passages of scripture, and it's after Jesus is resurrected from the grave. He's getting ready to go back to heaven, and he talks to one of his disciples, Peter, and he's telling him, Peter, you know, if you love me, please serve me. And Peter says, I love you, I love you, I love you, I really do. And Jesus then says, okay, I know you love me, and now let me tell you how you're going to die. And Peter is a little taken aback by that, and he says, okay, so you're just telling me I'm going to die. And he looks at one of the other disciples, John, and he says, so what about him? What, you know, you got any pearls of wisdom to drop on John tonight, and, you know, besides the one that you're giving me? And I love what Jesus' response. John 21, verse 22, Jesus answered and he said, if I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me. You guys, I call that the witty principle, the what is that to you principle. And it has such marvelous applications in our lives. from why does she get to drive that car and I drive this car? Why is her husband so nice to her and my husband is a jerk? Why did she get those kids and I got these kids? Why does she have, oh, come on, you've asked it, you know you have. Or a more painful question, why does she have children and I don't? Or why is she married and I'm not? Or why does she have good health and I don't? Why do you elevate her and let her have a position and you don't me? And we spend our lives, rather than looking for inspiration and encouragement from each other, we look with judgment. And basically, we're not really mad at the other women in our lives. We're mad at God. And we say, God, you have not treated me fairly. And Jesus' response is the same whether it's the car that you're driving or not driving, the husband you have or don't have, the children you have or you don't have, the job that you want and somebody else got it and she's not even nearly as good as you are, the recognition that should have come your way and didn't. It doesn't really matter because Jesus' response is the same every single time and he hits me with this every day. I kid you not. What is that to you, Kay? Your only job is to follow me. So if we're going to look at each other, I would want to go on to the ninth thing. Instead of being envious of someone else's calling or arrogant about your calling, let's be inspired and encouraged by each other. And I want to share with you quickly some women whose lives inspire me. First is a gal named Mary from Rwanda. Mary was born in Rwanda, but there was a genocide early on, and her parents fled as refugees to Uganda. Her pregnant mother walked with Mary to Uganda, which is a little bit of a walk. And so Mary was raised in a refugee camp. But in that refugee camp, when the genocide hit Rwanda in 1994, Mary and her husband and their toddler children went back to Rwanda while the streets were still full of bodies, while there was still blood running in the street, while there was still chaos reigning in that country. And Mary went and said, I know what it's like to be a vulnerable person, and we will give our lives to our fellow Rwandans. And today, Mary is an amazing advocate for orphans and vulnerable children, and she is a fighter, and she inspires me. Robbie and Bushra. Yay, Mary. Robbie and Bushra. Robbie is a Jew and Bushra is a Muslim. And they live in Palestine and both have lost a son in the violence that is going on there. And they have decided that they're going to work for peace. And even though folks in their own communities call them traitors and threaten them, these two women have decided that their work for peace is holy work and nothing is going to dissuade them from doing it. And they inspire me. Some of you may know Malala, if you've watched the news in the last few years. Malala was a Pakistani teenager who spoke up that women should be educated, and the Taliban didn't like that very much. And after a few threats, they shot her in the head and left her for dead. And she survived three gunshot wounds, and today is a passionate advocate at like 19 years old for women and for education. And she's taken what could have been an absolute, if it were me, I truly can't imagine after being shot in the head that I would go back and try to be an advocate for anything. But Malala is an incredibly brave young woman and she inspires and she encourages me. Closer to home. A few months ago in South Carolina, there was a terrible, horrendous murder of 9 people in a church in South Carolina. And in the horror and the shock and the anguish of those moments, some of the families of those who were murdered within hours stood publicly and said, I forgive the man who killed my loved one. That's something that I don't know that I have. But these families have helped change the conversation in our nation because they have responded with God's grace and his mercy and his forgiveness. And they inspire and encourage me. Quickly, I'm going to tell you about some women really close. My daughter, Amy, is one of my heroes. She is my hero. She fights valiantly. You heard her speak on Mother's Day, and she fights valiantly every single day, physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually, for help. She lives with Lyme disease, and her children live with Lyme disease, and every day is a bit of a battle. And there have been some days when getting out of bed to brush her teeth was a good day. And when Amy continues to seek God and to seek help for not just herself, but for other people living with Lyme, she is a hero, and she inspires and encourages me. I am inspired and encouraged by a friend of mine who just finished 18 months of weekly step studies in Celebrate Recovery. Every Monday night, she has been there working on her hurts, her habits, and her hangups when it would have been so much easier to just give up and say it's too hard. But 18 months of every Monday night, and she inspires and encourages me. I have a friend who's lived with an eating disorder most of her life, and yet she relentlessly pursues healing in all the broken places of her life, even when it's incredibly uncomfortable and painful, and she inspires and encourages me. One more. I'm inspired by my friend Elizabeth, who put her money where her mouth was when it came to caring for orphans and vulnerable children. She adopted 3 precious children from Rwanda, and she inspires and encourages me. And in our church, I am inspired by every one of you who teaches a Sunday school class, who stands out there with those funny little big name tags and greets people as we come up week, day after day, for those of you who clean the toilets, who wash the windows, who hand out bulletins, those of you that sing in the choir, who sing, who lead worship, for those of you who host a junior high or senior high small group in your home, oh, praise God for you. For those of you that cook a meal for somebody who is sick, for those of you who make hospital calls, for those of you who've spent the months and months of becoming a lay counselor and you're there to share with people in our church, all the ways that you open your home and loving hospitality in your neighborhood, everything you do, you inspire and encourage me, and I love you. There is hope and inspiration truly everywhere we turn. Each one of these women that I've mentioned are like lights shining in a dark sky. The Bible says in Philippians that we are to live lives that are so beautiful and so compelling that they're like a star shining in the darkest night. In the darkness of war and conflict, Deborah and Jael, those women who feel so far removed from us, they shone like lights in the darkness. Those women that I mentioned to you, Rofi and Bushra and Malala and Mary. Who did I forget? Oh, and the families, the women in South Carolina, they've shone like stars in dark nights. My daughter, those 2 other friends I mentioned to you, and Elizabeth, they shine like stars on a dark night. And all of you, as you are serving God, living out your calling, you're shining like a light in a dark night. How would history have been different if Deborah and Jael had not shown up and taken God at his word? God would have found somebody, but things would have looked different. Those women that I just mentioned to you, life would be different in the places where they live had they not shown up and been lights in the dark places. So let me ask you, get really personal. How is your family going to be different because of the way you live your life? What old patterns within your family are you going to be the one that breaks the chain? What old habits, what old ways of responding, what old ways of doing things are you going to do? How is your generation going to be different than the generation that has come before you? How will the history of your neighborhood be different because you live in that condo or that house? How will you affect the people that get to see you in and out every single day living your life? How will your neighborhood be different because of the way that you are going to shine like light in a dark place? How is the history of your job going to be different because of the impact you left of small acts of kindness? Those small acts of service when everybody else was making fun of somebody and you were the person who was showing love. How is your job going to be different? How's the history of there going to be different because of you? Well, God's calling, we respond first in relationship. Then we respond in intimacy. Then we grow in holiness, and then in service, and then in faith. And as we close, I want to ask you that question. Where is it that tonight you might need to respond to a call? Maybe you've never had a relationship with God, or maybe in the past you did, or you knew something about him, but you really don't know what it means to have a personal relationship. And so your response to God's calling tonight would be that responding to the call of salvation. Some of you, you've been a Christian, you've been a Christ follower for a long time, but you don't really yet know what it's like to be in that intimacy, because if he said something to you, you're not sure you'd know it was his voice. That can be changed. You can spend time and you can say yes to that fellowship. Maybe the yes for you is in the area of living a holy life. Again, you've been a believer, but there's still some vestiges of living in an old way and old patterns that you know in your heart aren't right. You know they're not really holy. And you could say yes to that tonight to God. Maybe yours is saying yes to service, saying that calling of serving. You've been sitting on the sidelines. Maybe you've been like those tribes that wouldn't get involved for whatever reason. And you're willing to take a baby step and get involved and say yes. Maybe you would really love to shine like a light in a dark place and take some daring faith risk, some daring faith steps. Let me pray for you. God, would you help us to lead lives of daring faith like Deborah and Jael, to honor and embrace the particular calling that you have given to us, to cheer each other on as we run our own race, and to say yes to your call to be your woman where we are today. Father, for those women for whom this is that first moment of coming face to face with saying yes to you, if you're in that place, you can just pray this prayer quietly. You don't have to say it out loud. God will hear you. God, I don't really understand all that she's saying, but I think that what I hear her telling me is that you love me and that you want to be my friend and that you want to be my savior. And I don't even know what all that means, but as much as I know how, I give my life to you, Jesus. I ask you to forgive me of my sins and for trying to figure my life out on my own without you. I'd like to start fresh and new here and now tonight. And if you prayed that prayer, I can absolutely 100% promise you, based on what Jesus has already done for you, that he heard you and you are his friend and he is your savior. God, I pray a blessing on these women that I love. Use us to live out our calling, not in competition, in judgment, or criticism of each other, but living our lives, inspiring and encouraging others to greater faith and greater hope. In Jesus' name I pray.